Welcome, my sea devils and demons. This is Nurse Hatchet. You are listening to the Wolf Pack.
The horror community is going through changes, and I want to discuss it. Welcome to an awakening of horror with your host, William Pattison. Scares everybody, and welcome to this February edition of An Awakening of Horror. I'm your host, William Pattison, King of Splatter Punk, and author of the Camp Crystal Lake novels. Alrighty, so it is February, and that means for the horror community that it is Women in Horror Month. But also, it is Black History Month, and this year, Shudder has started a series called Horror Noir, and their first installment in this is on the contributions of black people in horror. And yeah, I do agree with Shudder that we do need, since it is Black History Month, we do need to acknowledge the contribution of African American, Tongan, all black people who have contributed to the horror community. I highly recommend that you check out Shudder's Horror Noir. It's an excellent documentary and, talks about the blaxploitation horror films, the old zombie films, and even some of the films where black people were not, black people in films were not even played by black people. It was white people in blackface there for a little while. But this month is, of course, Women in Horror Month, and I wanted to discuss it a little bit. I am very proud of how women in horror have been, getting their shit together the last few years, after what happened in 2014, because earlier than 2014, you had a lot of crap going on, the best way to explain this is there's this guy on YouTube that I've been listening to for the last year. He was doing complaint videos on Star Wars. And all of a sudden he stopped for a few months. And just recently he came back on. And he said that the reason why he stopped was because his mission statement for his company that he was building was to make $1 million within the next couple years. And his business was falling down because he spent all this time doing these videos on Star Wars. And, his mind was overwhelmed with Star Wars. He was going to see movies and stuff. And he wasn't focusing himself on what his goal was. And now he is focusing, I think he's focusing a little too much, because he's sitting there and saying that he's not even going to think about his family. He's married and he's not going to think about his marriage. All he's going to think about is his business and how to make those millions of dollars for his company. But what he did with this latest video is he talked about his ideas on his mission statement and stuff, and how an organization can, be detrimental to itself because it doesn't focus on what its goal is. And that was the problem around 2014 with women in horror is that they were not focusing on their goal, which their mission statement says that they want to promote women in horror who are not getting recognition, and to educate and to promote more women into horror, you know, getting them encouraged into horror. And the problem was that in 2014, you had members of Women in Horror who were ambassadors, supposed, you know, they called themselves ambassadors. But the problem with these women was all they were doing was self-promoting themselves, and they were acting in a detrimental way to women in horror. I mean, seriously, there was one situation that I keep mentioning about, but it's very telling about this. These ambassadors, they didn't like one person. And no, it wasn't me. It was another woman. And what they did is they started posting and blasting this woman with feminazi memes and stuff. You know, pictures of Hitler with a pink a female symbol thing on his arm. A woman in a Nazi uniform, you know, saying, "We are the feminazis," and all this, and, you know, and I mentioned all, you know, it was like, what the fuck are you people doing? You're representatives of Women in Horror, and you're going around announcing that you're feminazis and all this, and that you're, you know, and doing all this shit. You know, on top of that, you know, they were driving me nuts because, you know, when they started Women in Horror, I was a firm supporter. You know, I promoted Women in Horror very much. You know, then stuff started going downhill, and, you know, my dear friend D-Row, she walked away from it because she was just getting disgusted with all the self-promotion that was going on and stuff, and that, you know, it wasn't doing what it was supposed to be doing. And you know, a lot of people moved on from there. I mean, Day Green moved on, you know. There was a lot of people who just thought, "Oh my God, you know, I'm trying to promote this thing and they're doing this thing." And it was but yeah, things got worse, and you know, they were attacking people, anyone who said that Women in Horror wasn't doing their job, got attacked. You know, I remember this one guy, he did a article on it, "Do We Really Need Women in Horror Month?" And these women in horror ambassadors went in and acted like complete and utter fucking jerks. And a couple of them even attacked me because I had praised the guy on it. Yeah, you know, and said exactly what I've always said. You know, they should stand by their mission statement and do this. But, you know, they're in 2014 pretty much the only people besides their, you know, besides their ambassadors that they were promoting were the Saskas. And that was it. That was it. You had, you know, and, you know, the one thing that got me was, you know, in this, on the chat thing for this article, you know, do we need Women in Horror Month? You know, Jessica Cameron went on there and she goes, well, you know, you interviewed all these other people, but you didn't interview the Saskas. And she put the Saskas' name in capital letters and that. And I said, well, you know, I commented and she just started attacking me. But that was the way, you know, and supposedly she was an ambassador of Women in Horror at this time. And it was bad. It was bad. And then the thing is, what finally brought things to a head and it got to the point where the head of Women in Horror, Hannah Neurotica, had to step in. Literally had to step in and had to clean house. In 2014, a very ignorant and narrow-minded member of Women in Horror, I'm not going to mention her name, but she's a certain person who becomes totally unwound if you use the word bitch in front of her. But anyways, this person brought into Women in Horror a manipulator. I call her a manipulator because of the fact that she was. You know, she tried to manipulate me, but she didn't get away with it. I distanced myself from her at one point, but, you know, and I tried to warn this woman in horror about her, but she didn't listen to me. So she's bringing her in, introducing her to all these women in horror. This girl was lying her ass off on saying that she was a published author and all this. The fact is that this woman had only written 2.5-page stories, and she'd never even published them. That was it. And, you know, and she kept saying, oh, well, I'm going to be published. And I said, yeah, but you can't call yourself an author unless you've actually published and got acknowledged. You can't do that. And anyway, so, you know, this lady was introducing her, took her to Texas Frightmare, got in trouble with her best friend, introduced this person to the Saskas, introduced them to all the Women in Horror ones, and a lot of the Women in Horror was sitting going, who the hell is this person? But anyway, soon after, this woman showed her true intentions. Because I had basically put it out there that this woman had only written what she had written and that she wasn't a real author or anything, she decided that she was going to get me thrown out of the horror genre, that she was going to force me out of it. And she tried to start a group in Women in Horror, on the Women in Horror forums, to take me down, saying that I was a horrible danger to horror, and that I was, I was a person that they needed to destroy. They needed to get me out of there and destroy me. Well, what ended up happening is Hannah Neurotica found out about this, and she went after her, kicked her out of Women in Horror, and shut down the group and that, and basically told people, cleaned up the place, said no more self-promotion, no more of this game playing, no more of this. We're here to try to improve women in horror, trying to help women in horror, and you guys are being detrimental. And she started trying to make changes. Well, this woman that had gotten kicked out, she brought in a sociopathic piece of shit. I'm not even going to mention his name, but this guy went in and attacked the Women in Horror website. He attacked every member of Women in Horror that he could find on Facebook, and took down their Facebook profiles, hacked and took down their Facebook profiles, took down and hacked their Twitters, everything. Just totally demolished them. And, just all this because of this one person and her hateful vendetta bullshit. And the fact, what Hannah Neurotica and the other ones wouldn't believe, even though I told them, was that she even told me that she hated feminists, that she couldn't stand feminists, but she wanted to be in Women in Horror because of the power that it would give her, because she saw it as the place to get her free, get into the horror hierarchy for free. Well, anyways, so since then, since all that happened, things have changed with Women in Horror. Ambassadors have calmed their shit. They're now focusing on promoting women in horror that need help. I really wish they'd, do like a money campaign, even though there is a nonprofit. They're not going to be doing it wouldn't be a nonprofit, it wouldn't be a profit thing, but, put together some grants and get some women who want to be horror filmmakers, get them grants so that they can go to film school. Help them out that way. Really do some help. Because right now, what's the major thing that Women in Horror is doing? What's the biggest thing on their agenda for this month? And I still laugh at this because this is a leftover from the old Women in Horror that Debbie Rochon walked away from. And that is the Soska's blood drive. You know what? The fact is that the Soska's blood drive doesn't do anything for women in horror. Really, it doesn't. Even though they have women in the horror on the banner, it really doesn't help them. The people who it helps is the Soska's, because that's their promotion. You know, people even say it's the Soska's blood drive. It doesn't say that it's a women in horror blood drive. It doesn't, you know, and, you know, they don't sit there and talk about what women in horror stands for or anything. It's just, oh, well, you know, we're going to give blood and the blood's going to go to these charities. And it's like, you know, that's the thing, Jen and Sylvia, charity begins at home. Why don't you, rather than doing a blood drive, get a money thing going? Have people donate to put a female filmmaker through film school. That would be something that would promote women in horror. That would be something that would fit in with the mission statement. But of course, you know, because I'm a guy and I have a dick, you people don't want to even hear a word that I say. But that's the kind of thing that you need to do. You know, I mean, I'm absolutely proud of the fact that you guys are actually putting out profiles of women in horror and trying to get a lot of these authors and filmmakers and that kind of thing some recognition and to get their names out there. That is good. That is positive, and that is what you need to do. Is rather than sitting there talking about, you know, how men control the horror community. No, we don't control the horror community. It's just that's the way things turned out, because there's a lot more male filmmakers. Now, you want to promote and, you know, bring more women into filmmaking, make it a little bit more easier for them to do it by, instead of making women filmmakers sound like they're a bunch of feminists who hate men, why don't you try to make some tight films? I mean, you know, the thing is that, you know, feminist films don't sell because they're feminist films. They're for feminists. And, you know, I mean, seriously, that's what we're having. That's why we're having trouble with a lot of the franchises now. And yeah, I'll bring that in a little bit on the Star Wars thing. You know, the feminist agenda on Star Wars, the feminist agenda on Star Trek, the feminist agenda on Doctor Who. You know, oh, you know, they're making the men look stupid and that and all that. You know, thing is, feminists don't need to make men look stupid in horror films, because men write men as stupid in horror films. I mean, seriously, you look at most of the horror films that we've had since the 80s, and it's like, most of the men in these damn films look like they have a permanent hard-on. They're misogynistic jackasses. They're stupid as hell because they make the wrong decisions and end up getting themselves killed. You know, I mean, seriously, you know, women actually come out better in horror films than a lot of the men, because men are really given a really horrible image. But, I mean, you know, now I am back to supporting women in horror, and, you know, I'm not trying to cause shit for them. I'm just, saying that we can't forget the past. We cannot forget the dark time of women in horror where, radicals and people who were more self-centered were overriding the, better opportunities for women in horror. So now we're seeing women in horror doing better. I want people to start really promoting also Black History Month and Black Horror History as well, because they are really ignored quite a bit. They need to be given a little love as well. So just remember, February is not only Women in Horror Month, it's also Black History Month, and let's promote African Americans and other Black people in horror, because they're important too. And just be ready, because in March it is Artists in Horror Month and everybody gets recognition. Because that's the way Artists in Horror Month does it. We don't just promote one group, we promote everybody. And we want people in the horror community to send out appreciation letters to people in horror. Give them a little positive message. Let them know that we know that they're out there and that we know that they're working hard for horror and they deserve recognition. Let's do that, because I've been doing this for a number of years, and it has had a positive backlash in horror. I mean, look at the horror community now. There's a lot less cyberstalking. There's a lot less fighting. There's a lot less negativity. I mean, yes, we still have negativity. Shit, I'm still being cyberstalked. But, that's just me. But, on average, the horror community is doing really well. And when we come back from our music break, I will be talking about something that is happening with the Academy Awards. So, I will be talking about that after this music break. Enjoy!
I will not fall down. which way to go. It's hard to know when your soul is lost. I've seen how much I had to lose. Cause now I know just what I gotta do.
From within to push away my fear.
stand where I'm afraid. I am through with this, 'cause I am more than this. I promise to myself, alone and no one else. My flame is rising high.
Prime Credit. My name Peggy. You have question?
Okay, Peggy.
Yes, I have 100,000 reward points.
What are my options?
Oh, many options.
Ooh.
One, keychain. B, tracker cap. Look good for ladies.
Okay, how about cash?
Cash? You want cash?
Want better rewards?
Peggy,
switch to Discover, America's number one cash rewards program. It pays to...
She devils and demons. This is Nurse Hatchet, She-Wolf of the Wolf Pack.
Alrighty, so that was our music break. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Anyways, so let us talk right now for this segment about the Academy Awards. You know, 2018, I should say. The films were from 2017, but the 2018 Academy Awards was an incredible time for horror because of the fact that two horror films were up for Academy Awards and they won. You know, the last time we had had two horror films up for Academy Awards was 1953. That's right, 1953. The 2017 movies that were up were, of course, you know, Get Out and Shape of the Water. And, you know, that was an achievement. That was something that people in horror had been waiting for the longest time, because horror had been ignored. It had been a long time since the last time anything regarding horror had actually been up for an Academy Award. You know, the last time a horror film had anything in the Academy Awards, and this was, you know, a lot of people called it a thriller, but it was the Michelle Pfeiffer, Harrison Ford film, What Lies Beneath. And what it was that I believe it was up for screenplay, and Michelle Pfeiffer was up for an Academy Award for her performance in it. You know, before that, Michelle Pfeiffer and, who was her co-star? Jack Nicholson. Jack Nicholson was up for Wolf. But, you know, I mean, you know, there was just, you know, horror hardly ever got anything, and usually it was just an actor acknowledgement for maybe one film. You know, I mean, the last really big Academy Award thing was when The Exorcist was up for Best Picture. But anyways, yeah, so 2018 was an amazing year for horror. And the thing is that the last few years, horror films have been, you know, advancing. In some ways, you know, people would say that, oh, well, they're going back. You know, because now horror films are less gory. There's not a lot of nudity in the films. You have better characterization, and you have better plot work in these. They are maturing. You know, you're not seeing as many of the slasher films that, you know, that we used to see. You know, with their stereotypical, oh, well, we have to have the jock, we have to have the geek, we have to have the virgin, and we have to have the slut. You know, basically the Breakfast Club cast type thing. That's what I always thought of on the slasher films, was that it was the Breakfast Club, because most of these people and these groups, you wouldn't have them socializing together. I'm sorry, you wouldn't. Maybe at a party, yeah, but, you know, they wouldn't be friends. You know, I'm sorry to tell you this, but no. You, geeks and jocks were never friends. I know this because I lived through the 70s and the 80s, and I know that social network, and no, you never saw them shoot. When I was in school, all the African American people stayed on one side of the school. You had all the white people on another side, and you had the socias on the lawn during the main recess lunch hour. Seriously, there was such a separation in classes of people in school. I mean, shoot, we even had the druggies who would go out into the parking lot. So, you know, slasher films were never, they were fantasy, let's put it that way, when it came to the relationship of the characters and that. It was never realistic. And the way that they handled themselves was never realistic. You know, and that's one of the reasons why we enjoyed it. It was stupid people going out in the woods. But now we want more from it because, you know, after a while, gore becomes boring. And I remember in around 2000 through 2008, I used to get into real battles with people on message boards about characterization, about plot, about stuff, saying that, you know, characterizations and that characters, backgrounds, and that were important. You know, you needed that for a film. And these ones said, no, we don't. That's bullshit. All we need is a cool killer and cool murders. And it's like, you're on drugs. And I've been proven correct, because a lot of these ones, they went and took their attitude to actually making films, and we have a bunch of really fucked up, boring slasher films out there. I mean, seriously. Memorial Day. Remember Memorial Day, where, ugh, God. Anyway, so, but now this is all different. You know, it's different. We've, you know, people, the filmmakers nowadays are getting more psychological. The films are getting more interesting and more exciting. And we're finding that the filmmaking community is starting to take notice of this. And they're starting to acknowledge, and we need to keep going in that direction. Yeah, I'm really, you know, I'm pissed off about what the Academy has done. I haven't told you yet what the Academy has done. Okay. The Academy Awards this year, they are cutting out editing, photography, and special effects. They are not going to present those categories in the Academy Awards celebration. They are completely ignoring that part. And that is usually the parts where you find a lot of horror films, you find a lot of science fiction films, and you find fantasy films. So a lot of these people are going to be ignored by the Academy. Editors and that. And what's next? I ask you. What is the Academy going to cut out next? Writing? Oh my fucking God. It just blows me away that they're going to pull shit like this. Well, you know, what you could hear is their ideas. Well, no one's interested in hearing who edited a film. No one's interested in who shot the film. I mean, who cares about the photography of the film? The photography of the film is very important, since a film is a visual medium and photography is what makes a film at times. Editing makes a film at times. You can take a shitty film and through brilliant editing, you can make a bad film good. You know, and special effects. What do you mean people aren't interested in special effects? There's been so many documentaries on special effects that it's crazy to sit there and say that people are not interested in special effects. Give me a fucking break. So anyways, yeah, so the Academy Awards are cutting out those categories because they think that the public doesn't want them, and they want to cut down the amount of time that the special is, because a lot of people tune out. Yeah, well, maybe because most of the films that you put up for Academy Awards are ones that people aren't interested in. You know, it's something that I hate about the Academy is that fucking arrogance of theirs. It's just like when I was dealing in film school with critics, film critics. They would sit there and lecture our film class and basically say, well, the public doesn't understand what a good film is. We are the only ones who understand what a good film is. Give me a fucking break. What's a good film is what gets the people into the seats. It's what people will watch more than once. It is called something that entertains people. It's not your fucking arrogance, nose up in the air bullshit. You know, it just, God. I just want to fucking yell at the screen when I watch the Academy Awards. I stopped watching the Academy Awards like 3 years ago because I couldn't deal with it anymore. It just drove me nuts. Because half of these films I didn't even know. And it's like, later on, you know, I'd check some of them out to see, well, you know, maybe it's good. Maybe it's good. You know. Over the years, I've found a handful that were really good. I mean, one that was up for the Academy Awards years ago called The Dresser. That was a really good film. I really enjoyed it. They recently did a remake of it. And it was horrible. It really was. It was absolutely horrible. It had none of the grace that the original film had. But most of these films that they put up for Academy Awards are ones that your average person wouldn't even want to look at. because they have, you know, they don't relate to it or anything. I mean, there's a few of them that are really powerful films that I've seen over the years. It's like, you know, some of them have some pretty powerful messages, like Schindler's List and that. I love Schindler's List or Pearl Harbor or stuff like that, historical stuff. Very interesting. But, you know, a lot of them, not even interested. You know, they're the type of films that bore me to death. And they're the type of films that bore most people to death. But, yeah, I mean, you know, why can't the Academy Awards be more rounded, well-rounded, you know, add in some horror, add in some science fiction. You know, there's a lot of science fiction films that come out. Some of them might be actually worth checking out for the Academy Award. But these people don't. And, you know, one thing that I found out years ago that really irked me was that I found out a couple of facts about the Academy Awards. The Academy, the films that get nominated for the Academy Awards are the ones that promote themselves the best. So it's all about how much money the studios throw into promotion. Also, members of the Academy, half of them don't even watch the damn films. They'll send their chauffeur, they'll send one of the maids, or they'll send, you know, one of their assistants to go and watch the film and tell them, oh, well, is it good? And, you know, Fifi or whatever the fucker name is will say, oh, yes, Mister, oh, yeah, you're very good. I really liked it. And it's like, okay, so there's a vote that is bullshit. You know, it's sad. It's sad the way these ones are. You know, now we're getting in a younger group that is actually watching the films, though. And that's why Shape of the Water and Get Out actually got in there. There was a lot of people who wanted to not accept the nominations of those two films. They tried to fight about it. So, you know, not cool. So, anyways, yeah, so hopefully the Academy Awards are going to start opening up a lot more, and we're going to see a time when horror and science fiction and that are given a little bit more love. Of course, you know, if we keep up with the good work that we're doing and putting out some good films, you know, I mean, seriously, I mean, we've got a few good ones. I mean, I just watched a film that I thought was very well done, and that was Overlord. You know, I don't know if it's going to be up for an Academy Award next year or not. I can't say. But I doubt it. But all I can say is that I'm now really starting to enjoy some of these horror films. Alrighty, so anyways, that was all I wanted to say for this edition of An Awakening of Horror. As always, this is William Pattison saying, keep America strong, watch horror films. Catch you the next time I have anything interesting to talk about in regard to horror.
Try to fight it, the more you try to hide it, the more infected, rejected, you feel alone inside it. You know you can't deny it, the world's a little more fucked up every day. I'm gonna save you from it, together we'll outrun it. Just don't get into the fear. So many things I would have told you if I knew that I was never gonna see you again. I wanna lift you up
Internet. Ah!